It's great to be here. It's great to be back in Pennsylvania. I spent many formative years in Philadelphia. My first job was a fifth grade teacher, and I did teach the severely gifted, as we called them, at Dickinson College. So I have lots of fond associations with this part of the world. And I want to thank Kathleen and Kara and Debbie and all the fantastic staff at WITF for providing this opportunity. We had a great event here last night with about 20-plus preschool teachers, and you may have seen some of the activities as you were walking in. I gave a short presentation, and then we got to play. And to sort of play with great hands-on STEM activities and, making binoculars out of toilet paper tubes and figuring out how to make the sound of rain by putting toothpicks and some of you are shaking your head. Maybe you've done this. Can you put toothpicks and rice in a bottle? And you should have seen these adults looking like four-year-olds as they were trying to figure it out. And there was one woman there who is a director of a preschool, and she told me that she's been in the business for 25 years, and whenever she does these trainings, she's always looking for something new. I want something new. It's always the same old stuff. And she said, this is new. And this is new. So thank you, WITF, for providing leadership in this important subject of preschool STEM learning. It was new to us. When we first started thinking about Curious George, the television series in 2004, the term STEM really was not in our vocabulary. We thought about the curriculum in terms of science, math, and design engineering. We didn't really adopt the acronym STEM until a few years later when it became more mainstream. So STEM is still a relatively newcomer on the educational scene, and STEM for preschool is really cutting edge. So it's great to have this opportunity again to think with you all about how we can help shape such vital learning at such a vitally important time in kids' development. When I tell folks that I work on Curious George, they invariably turn into their four-year-old selves. Their eyes light up, they say something gushy about how much they love Curious George, which does speak to his amazing staying power as he's approaching his 75th birthday. And I tell my friends that I'm a rock star on the playground, but secretly, I am a little disappointed that the first thing out of people's mouths is their love for their character instead of how much their kids learn from the show, although I certainly do hear stories about that as well. But it's because we spend so much time thinking about the curriculum. So personally, it's just great for me to be able to come here today and talk to you about one of my favorite subjects and something I don't get invited to talk about enough, preschool STEM learning. But before we get into that, I would like to talk about our perceptions of STEM learners. Because for many adults out there, and perhaps for some of you in here, this is what you think the STEM learner looks like. The lab-coated scientist, perhaps working for NASA or MIT. The bespectacled nerd with the calculator watch. Many of us have these preconceived ideas of what STEM learning looks like, and these stereotypes can inspire fear, intimidation, perhaps a sense of failure if you were like me in 11th grade chemistry. But here's what STEM learning looks like to a preschooler. George is the archetypal preschool STEM learner. He is, of course, famously curious about everything, as are preschoolers. And I know a lot of you work with preschoolers. Have you ever tried walking down the street with a three-year-old? It takes forever. They have to stop and examine every crack. They look at the bugs. They look at the leaves. They are natural explorers, just like George. Preschoolers go around putting things in their mouths, touching things, sometimes breakable things, slamming doors just to hear how they sound. They dig in the dirt, they stare at the sky, they use all sorts of tools, a wrench or a pickle, doesn't really matter. They take things apart and put them back together again, not always in the right way. So just like George, preschoolers are on a mission to understand their world by exploring and manipulating it in a direct, hands-on way. They are natural little scientists. So for many of us who have this sort of stereotypical idea of who a STEM learner is, that lab-coated scientist, it really has nothing to do with the reality of how preschoolers experience STEM learning. And in fact, our perceptions can sometimes lead us to give up before we even try to help these natural little scientists. In fact, research shows that preschool teachers tend to spend less time on science than on any other pre-academic area because they aren't comfortable with it or they feel a lack of confidence teaching it. As a result, children are less prepared when they enter kindergarten. But the truth is, when you break it down and understand what STEM really means to a preschooler, it's not that scary. In fact, it may be happening right now in your classrooms or in your school districts under the guise of a different name. Exploration, observation, asking questions, making predictions. So if you think you need to be wearing a lab coat to teach STEM learning to preschoolers, I invite you to think like a monkey and follow the example of Curious George. But before we dive in and talk about that, I want to provide some context for why we're here today. Why is STEM so important for today's youth? And there are many reasons why, and perhaps you're already familiar with these reasons, so please bear with me if this is familiar ground, but I thought it might be worth restating just to provide a framework for our discussions later. President Obama identified STEM education as a crucial piece of his economic recovery plan when he took office in 2009. We've all heard that industrial jobs are disappearing, technology jobs are replacing them. We need a better educated workforce, more scientists, more engineers to fuel the new technologically based economy and make us more competitive. You may be familiar with the fact that American kids are lagging behind their international cohorts in math and science. According to the 2006 Program for International Student Assessment Comparison, American students rank 21st out of 30 in science literacy among students from developed countries and 25th out of 30 in math literacy. These would be troubling statistics at any time, but today especially in light of the demand for future jobs in science and technology. So STEM education is incredibly important for our economic growth and development, but it's also important in addressing social inequities. Perhaps you've also heard that women and minorities are severely underrepresented in science and engineering fields, all of the above. Currently, women account for nearly half, 46%, of the U.S. labor force, but make up just 11% of all engineers in this country. Meanwhile, blacks and Latinos account for a mere 7% of the STEM workforce, despite making up nearly 28% of the U.S. population. Most STEM-related jobs are held by whites, 73%. So there are some social inequities that need to be addressed through STEM education in order to provide greater access to economic opportunity for all Americans. But even if you're not destined to become an engineer, even if you become an English major like me, STEM education is still important. Research shows that early exposure to STEM, whether it be in preschool, at a museum, at your local PBS station, or just engaging in the natural trial and error of play, supports children's overall academic development and develops their critical thinking and reasoning skills. Because after all, at its core, STEM is about problem solving. And life, no matter what your profession, is full of problems. So STEM education is vital for every child, especially for preschoolers who are laying down the neurological tracks that will take them on their future educational journeys. Okay, so now that we've addressed the basic need for STEM, some other background, what is it? What exactly is STEM? And please, again, bear with me. If this is familiar ground, I promise you, you will be seeing clips of George very shortly. So STEM, S for science. When we think about science, we think about plants, living systems, the earth, natural resources, animals, all the elements of the natural world. We also think about the scientific process, making a hypothesis, predicting an outcome, experimenting. When we think about technology, most of us think about something like the iPad there in the upper left corner, or a computer, or an electron microscope, some kind of electronic technology. But in fact, that's really just a narrow definition of what technology is. And the definition that we use on George, and one that I think is really relevant for preschoolers, is anything that's humanly made or altered. So unlike the natural world of science, technology is the man-made world. It could include a pen, a vending machine, a building, a windmill, a bridge, the chairs that you're sitting on, your clothing. Anything man-made has been touched by an engineer, a team of engineers, and that's technology, and it's everywhere. I'm going to skip over the E and go directly to the M for math. When we think about math, we think about Venn diagrams, number sense, counting, measuring, all pretty basic stuff, nothing that controversial here. Back to the E for engineering, and I save this for last because engineering really combines all three disciplines, science, math, and technology, and applies them in a real-world context. So, for example, an engineer might observe a strong web of a spider by using science, and she might measure how the web holds many things times its weight, like itself, using math. She may design a fishing net, which is a type of technology, to hold fish many times the weight of the net. So in this case, an engineer observes nature, which sparks creativity and problem solving and spawns a man-made product that serves a function. That is engineering. I think it's very cool. So STEM, science, technology, engineering, and math, is a combination of all those fields, and obviously it covers a lot of territory, and we do touch on a very wide range of topics in Curious George, but really what it comes down to, and sort of the way that I think about it, and a sort of way to simplify it, is that there are three main pillars for STEM learning at the preschool level. Exploration, inquiry, and problem solving. So now we get to see some of those in action. In our series, we try to show George engaged in STEM inquiry in a very natural way, through the way monkeys and preschoolers normally play and interact with the world. So just like a preschooler, George is in active exploration mode as he moves through the world, gathering information through hands-on learning using all his five monkey senses. And here's a clip that demonstrates that.
It was one of those country mornings when George would have slept late if a strange sound didn't wake him up. On a windy day, the country house windows were almost musical. As good as the wind sounded, it felt even better. Smelled good, too. There had to be lots of things a clever monkey could fly out his window, like heavy winter socks. Birds he drew. His lucky brick. And there was even better stuff downstairs.
What's the excitement, George? Yeah, it's a great day to play in the wind. I'll get the door for you. George, if you're wondering how a big yellow hat would fly, you know the rule, buddy. No one is allowed to play with the yellow hat. Have fun. Clean up after yourself. And don't blow away.
George couldn't decide what he'd fly first. And then he didn't have to.
So there George uses all of his senses to actively and directly explore wind, right? He hears it, he feels it, he even smells it. And of course, his explorations are fueled by curiosity. At the beginning of the clip, he asks, "What was that strange sound?" And that leads to the next pillar of preschool STEM, inquiry, or asking questions. Of course, preschoolers are famous for asking questions. Why? What's that? Why? Inquiry is another way that preschoolers are hardwired to learn, and it's also an essential component of STEM learning. So in every episode of George, there's a problem that starts with a question. To demonstrate this, I'm going to show you a clip from an episode where George and the man with the yellow hat go to Australia. And where we come in now, they've just completed a long day in the outback looking at cool, unusual animals, and they have finished dinner.
Thanks, that was a great meal.
Why don't you get some shut-eye?
Yes, you have a big day tomorrow.
Okay. I'll set up our beds.
These were the biggest footprints George had ever seen. He wondered who or what made them.
Oh, here.
Everyone else's footprints went one in front of the other.
Huh?
But these footprints were side by side. Really far apart. The only way you could get that far and keep your feet side by side was by hopping. Rabbits hopped. Maybe it was a giant rabbit. Or clowns have big footprints. Maybe it was a hopping clown. Or maybe it was a giant hopping clown rabbit.
George, it's bedtime.
So you can probably guess where that goes. George makes friends with a kangaroo, and there is nothing cuter than a monkey and a kangaroo. George can't talk, but we have this device of using a narrator to sort of vocalize his thought processes, and we also have these thought balloons also so you kids can see what he's thinking. And then, of course, he has his famous expression, which we use a lot. But you saw in the clip how many questions he asks. Who made those footprints? How come they're side by side? What could hop that far? Could it be a giant hopping rabbit clown? And we like to have a lot of fun with monkey logic. We call it monkey logic, which is, you know, strikingly similar to preschool logic and the wacky things that kids say when they're trying to make sense of the world. So, but they're problem solving. It may seem kind of like funny nonsense to us, but they're actually trying to think and answer questions. So inquiry and exploration go hand in hand, and they lead to the third pillar, which is problem solving. In every episode of George, he's always solving a problem. Some problems are self-created, like the time that he poked a hole in the man's yellow hat and had to fix it. And some problems he accidentally stumbles upon, like the one you're going to see here, where George is walking home from the store.
That sounded like a chicken in trouble. George could see those six chicks needed to be rescued. George took two because it seemed safest. That left four on the island. Tracy was so happy she'd have kissed him. But chickens don't have lips. Unfortunately, the chicks enjoyed being rescued by George too much to do it just once. So now, he had six chicks to rescue. Again. They didn't need a rescue ferry. What they needed was a way to cross back and forth for fun. They needed a bridge. This looked like a good bridge. But it was too short. George was getting so hungry, it was hard to think. Couldn't think of any way to make a branch longer. He could make this longer. But could chicks walk on it? He needed something wide and flat. Repeat the same pattern until it was long enough.
So, in his problem solving, he actually is experimenting with various ways of getting those chicks back to their mother, right? He uses his body, he tries using a stick, makes a stick out of marshmallows and toothpicks, and eventually lands on the idea of making a bridge. So we always try to show that problem solving is a process. You rarely get the right answer right out of the gate. And in fact, as any scientist or anyone really who's ever learned anything would tell you, failure is a huge and important part of learning. And in fact, I kind of debated about making failure one of the pillars. But even I had my own ambivalence about that because we're not supposed to embrace failure, or failure has a connotation. But we really don't think about failure as a bad thing. George fails a lot, but he never gives up. And just like in the clip, if one idea doesn't work, it will give him information that will lead to the next idea that could fail, but then he will make his adjustments, and he goes from there until he reaches his solution. So we try to model for kids that you really can't fail. When you are experimenting, it's all data. And I think it also sends a good message to kids about resiliency, which is another topic for a summit, which I hope that we could have one day, because I think that's also really important for today's preschoolers. But the three pillars then of back to the three pillars. We had exploration, inquiry, problem solving. They captured the STEM process, their habits of mind and critical thinking skills that provide a foundation for young children and prepare them for future learning when they enter school. We didn't come up with these ideas on our own. We work very closely with our advisors who helped us shape the curriculum, who review every episode for accuracy and to make sure that it's appropriate for our audience. And they also told us that preschoolers, because they're such concrete learners, really need to see other kids sort of doing the things that George does in the animated show so that they can make the connections to the real world. So every animated episode of George ends with a live-action segment that shows real-life kids engaged in some hands-on activity that relates to the things that George learned. And these live-action segments are intended to help kids make connections to the everyday world and to inspire them to do STEM explorations on their own. I am going to show you a clip of kids who are learning about wind power.
George is a monkey. He figured out how to use wind power to make the scarecrow move.
We are playing with the wind today.
It's air just moving around. If the wind's going fast enough, we can fly a kite.
We made pinwheels to see how fast the wind was blowing.
We started with a square piece of paper, and we drew corner to corner, and then cut almost all the way down, and then we folded every other triangle into the middle, and then tape in the center so it stays down.
The wind blew it away.
My mom is helping us stick the thumbtack into our pinwheel. This catches the wind.
As you can see, it spins because of the wind. I can tell how fast the wind is. I think there's enough wind to fly the kite.
You need a lot of wind speed to get the kite in the air.
It's called an anemometer.
It shows you how fast the wind's going.
The anemometer was made with four cups, some cardboard, and a wooden stick.
Right now, it's not moving, which means there's no wind.
So we can try to find another place that has better wind.
We went to the top of the hill to find faster wind.
Start. One.
Our anemometer has one red cup, so we can count how many times it spins.
Done.
In 10 seconds, it went four times around.
Not fast enough to fly the kite.
One. Two.
Then the wind picked up a little.
Seven, eight, nine.
Done. It turned 9 times in 10 seconds.
There is enough wind to get the kite off.
Wind is interesting because it's natural. We don't create it. It's natural energy.
So that is that's an example of a live-action segment. And in fact, we have on our Curious George website, we have the pinwheel activity, which is one of the most popular activities that parents and teachers download all the time, and I can tell you from firsthand experience, it's really fun. Besides watching television, kids can engage in all sorts of STEM-related activities. As I mentioned, we have stuff to download on our website, but we also have great games like this game here, where kids get to make a sandcastle and in the process experiment with the right proportion of sand and water. So it's an engineering game. And it's really fun. It is the most popular site on pbskids.org. So I hope that I've made the case for you today about why STEM education is important and how Curious George can be a great role model for kids, and how we have lots of great resources that can be used in classrooms. But perhaps some of you may be wondering, do I really want to be pushing to have more media as a teaching tool for preschoolers? I mean, after all, don't we already have enough of this? kids on cell phones, babies hooked up to televisions and computers. If you believe that media doesn't belong in the classroom, I understand. In fact, I think it's important to have a healthy skepticism about educational media because there's a lot of examples of overuse and just simply bad stuff out there, although I'm not going to name names, and it's certainly nothing on PBS. But as a former teacher myself, and something just to echo what Kathleen said earlier, I know that there's no substitute for a good teacher or a good parent for that matter, and that media is really, it shouldn't replace what teachers do, but it can certainly have a really important role in supporting what teachers can do, and it can be their partner if it's done effectively. Which I am very proud to say Curious George does. It really does add value, and we can now say emphatically that kids do in fact learn from watching Curious George. We know this because we conducted research that found that preschoolers scored significantly better on the science and math concepts covered in episodes viewed than those kids who did not watch those episodes. And somewhat surprisingly, we learned that 84% of parents reported that the series made them more confident about helping their kids learn science and math. Parents got a lot of ideas for things that they could do from watching the animated show and the live-action segments. And I would imagine that that would extend to educators as well. So if you'd like to find more about the research, I've included the URL there. The study is posted on our website. This news about raising parent confidence levels was really music to my ears because I hope that what we do provides a launch pad for STEM inquiries that takes place after the television and computer is turned off. Because each of us can have an important and lasting impact in a child's educational growth, as this quote from Rachel Carson suggests. If a child is to keep alive his inborn sense of wonder, he needs the companionship of at least one adult who can share it, rediscovering with him the joy, excitement, and mystery of the world we live in. So I hope that I've demystified STEM learning for you and showed that for preschoolers, it's a very natural thing. It's something that you can encourage through exploration, inquiry, and problem solving. I hope that I've persuaded you that Curious George can be a great resource and partner to prompt STEM learning, and that there are ways for educators to play a role in this process. I don't know how many of you are actually in the classroom, but one thing that we talked about last night with teachers is you could show an episode of George, you could stop it at key points, and ask kids, what do you think? What do you think is going to happen? How would you solve this? What should Curious George do? So asking open-ended questions, or you can download any one of the many activities and you'll have a chance to play with them yourself later on your way out that encourage problem solving. And most importantly, it's important to know that you have the freedom to say, I don't know, if you don't know the answer. Because the beautiful thing about it is that you get then to be a partner in learning and to be a monkey and do what George would do.